to do a short stream to talk about the build I used for getting my my solo Greater Rift 75 for one of the conquests this season, which I completed last night. Reached Greater Rift 75 solo. Now, I just started playing this game in the last week or two. My friends bought it for me, so we'd have something to do. And as such, I just picked a monk kind of arbitrarily. I was using the seasonal Innis set that comes with the Patriot's Gift for completing the first four chapters of the season objectives, which is a good set if you're doing support. I kind of hit a wall around like Torment 10 as far as being able to actually do damage. So I switched to the Sunwoko set. And Icy Veins has a good guide on this set for solo DPS, but I had to tweak some things for survivability concerns when I started getting into the much higher level rift. Like for instance, the recommended belt for the set is the Witching Hour, because it has the increased attack speed and the critical hit damage, which you can spike damage pretty high. But let me go to a group of some enemies and I'll show you one of the concerns I have with it. So, a big part of this build relies on the fact that you can use Wave of Light. So, everything here is to optimize Wave of Light casting. And another part is the fact that the Vengeful Wind increases the maximum stack count of Sweeping Wind, which is kind of what Wave of Light draws its power off of, based on the set bonus for the Sunwoku set, which, as you see down for the 6-piece set, all those different things are increased by 1,000% for every stack of Sweeping Wind. So the more stacks you have, the better. And when you fire up Sweeping Wind, you have... Okay. So you have to keep on trying to hit enemies to get your stacks built up, and that affects your damage. One of the problems with this is if you go long enough without hitting or killing someone, then your stacks will vanish and you have to start over again. So your damage is constantly going on an up and down kind of cycle. Which means you're constantly having to run toward your enemy. Not always the best way to go about it. Because as you start getting those higher, greater rifts, you'll find yourself charging more toward a group just to maintain your stacks strike. When you don't really have the help available to do it. So I was finding myself dying quite a bit in the higher levels. So alternatively, this is one of the changes I made to the build. The Kiyoshiro's Soul Legendary Belt. Sweeping Wind gains 2 stacks every second and does not deal damage. So you can cast it and it will spin up automatically to the max stacks. Hold on 1 second, I can adjust my sound. I realize I don't have my headphones activated. And I'm probably getting sound bleed over for the stream. Alright. Here we go. So with that belt, I'm not spiking as high damage wise because my crits are reduced slightly. But I'm consistently having much higher damage because I'm always at that stack level 10, and I can hang back if I need to get health back or what have you. Also, I should mention if you're chasing if you're chasing conquests for the seasonal, I really recommend using the Corvus Ruins where I am now for getting Avarice, which is your 50 million gold count streak. I did this yesterday as well. So now a word about the skills and my Paragon points. So under the utility, I went all in for damage, resource cost reduction, life per hit. Haven't put anything into gold find really, because this is not really what you're after in the Greater Rift. Life regeneration, and resist all is what I really put my stuff into. Starting to work on my armor now that I got that. Offense, I'm not really doing physical attacks with this build. It's all ranged using the Wave of Light. So I didn't put anything into attack speed. It was all cooldown reduction, and then into my critical hit chance and damage. And then under here, maxed out movement speed and maximum spirit. Was pushing more into vitality initially because I'm trying to stay around a million hit points, which sounds like a lot until you're like on Torment 70 plus. And like I said, I'm using that soul belt for adding to the stacks, which is where the majority of the damage comes from. You want to get Sokrin's Gaze, the helmet, because this allows you to cast a Wave of Light, because normally it'll cast right at your feet, and as you see, when I'm using it, I can put it pretty much anywhere, which is greatly helpful. If you don't have that particular helmet on, then it'll drop pretty much right in front of you every time. So for the skills, this would be my Spirit Builder, which I'm really not making any use of. Of course, I have the Rising Tide modifier or rune. Each enemy hit generates additional spirit, so if I do happen to punch someone, I'm getting more spirit. The Explosive Light mod is what puts off those the shrapnel pieces you see there on the Wave of Light, which is really big for maximizing the damage you're doing with this build. Sweeping Wind, as I said, is integral because the multiplier hinges entirely on how many stacks you have of this. And then, of course, have the Inner Storm, gain more spirit whenever the Vortex is at three or more stacks. Now, I have the Mystic Ally, the Air Ally. As soon as you activate that one, you get a burst of spirit. I think it's about 100 points, and I'm at a little over 300. So I get about a third of my spirit back instantly for using the Air Ally. This build relies heavily on having as much spirit generation as possible, because when you start spamming Wave of Light, you'll go through it very quickly. Epiphany is huge. It has a long cooldown, but that increases your spirit generation per second, and you can dash straight to a target, which is both good and bad, because this is no longer really a melee build. I'm primarily ranged. I'll show you what it looks like when you're running through your stacks and your spirit and cast Epiphany. So I'm just hitting as fast as I can. You can see it's draining very quickly. Then I cast Epiphany and it refills very, very quickly. And that stays active for a bit, and if I click on an enemy, that moment of my already ran out 15 seconds. Yeah, it already ran out 15 seconds. My bad. Then that was using the Mystic Ally to get the quick recharge while I'm waiting for Epiphany to finish cooling down. So that's pretty much how this will work, is constantly... Yeah, that was instant teleport from Epiphany. It's constantly switching back and forth between using your Epiphany and that little boost from the Mystic Ally to keep your spirit high so you keep casting Wave of Light. Mantra of Salvation, along with the Wind Through the Reeds. This is mainly for the resistance elements and increased movement speed. So if you have an oh shit moment where you're about to get taken out, cast that, and usually it's enough to get you to run clear. One of the reasons why I focused on having my movement speed up as high as possible. And as well, I have the illusory boots in my my build, so I can move unhindered through enemies, which really helps you to break clear of a group if you're starting to struggle. Because in the higher, greater rift levels, this is very much a glass cannon build. But as you can see, I can run straight through these guys, not be slowed down. So mobility is very, very important in this build, to try to get yourself into a spot where you can cast the Wave of Light, where it will do the most effect, and trying to stay out of the way of enemies or the range of attacks. Going back real quick to the trying to use this for farming the Avarice Conquest, you're going to want to run through the entire map once, from the start all the way to wherever it ends, which will activate most of those scarab swarms to climb over the walls, and then you do your kill streak on the way back. So in the passive skills, near-death experience I think is really essential if you're going for the really high rifts, because you're going to run into a situation where someone drops some arcane emitters and you get taken out before you even have a chance to react. That gives you basically an extra life. Sixth Sense, reduce all non-physical damage taken by 25%, so you really want that damage reduction. Harmony, 40% of your single elemental resistances kind of blend together to be resistance of all elements. So if you have an item, for instance, that has just straight fire resistance, a portion of that will go toward resisting all elements. And the Guardian's Path, while dual wielding, 35% chance to dodge incoming attacks while you're carrying two-handed weapon. Get increased spirit generation. So I'm dual wielding because a big part of the build comes off of the Vengeful Wind that increases your sweeping wind stacks. So the extra dodge is really helpful in aiding survivability. Now, if you want, you can switch out one of these for which one is it? That's not Harmony. Beacon of Etar, which will reduce all cooldowns by 20%. I haven't really had a problem with surviving in between the cooldowns for Epiphany and Mystic Ally, as long as you have the Flawless Royal Topaz slotted, which reduces your resource costs. Part of the build already is getting a 50% reduction to the cast cost. Which item is that? One of these items gives me a reduction. Oh yeah, the focus and restraint set piece really helps with your damage out for the wave light. Also, when you hit with the resource spinning attack, deal 50% extra damage for 5 seconds. So you're almost constantly hitting with it. I don't make use of the first half hitting with the resource generating attacks as much, because this is, like I said, this is a glass cannon build. Item is it? Yeah, you'll see most of these items buff the damage that is put out by Wave of Light. Damage taken is reduced by 50% when Sweeping Wind is active. I thought it had something to cut down. down the casting costs by 50% right out of the gate, but I can't remember. Not seeing it. Anyway, so if you're worried about your cooldown costs, you could put in the Beacon Vitar. So I'm gonna head back to town and jump into a Greater Rift. I'm probably not gonna go all the way to 75 just because it's kind of a pain. Oh, I should talk a little bit about the Templar. I have him with a relic that. Ooh, that is not the relic we should be having. He should have the invincibility relic. There we go. Because it's much less important for him to have access to all of his skills or do any type of DPS, because at the higher torment levels and higher Greater Rift levels, he's not doing anything other than being a distraction. You want him to be up as much as possible. There you go. Heals, life regen. Yeah, this one has a chance to stun, so a little bit of crowd control is good. And this is the most important reason I have him along, is increases my research generation. So there we go. Stick that back in my stash. Scrap this garbage before I head into the rift. Yeah. I'm gonna go slow to 70. So first step is to get the stacks to spin up, and then we start attacking. Now, I talked a little bit about the Ring of Royal Grandeur that I used to be able to get that helmet in play. I'm not actually wearing it. You saw I was wearing the Focus and Restraint set for the rings, so I actually have that in my Kanai's Cube. I also have the Nemesis Bracers in my Kanai's Cube set, which helps me with the speed that I can complete the rift set. Highly recommend having that in your build if you are doing greater rift runs, because at this level, most of the enemies can take you out, so you're kind of obligated to kill most of the ones you come across. Crap. And like right here, I would have ran out of my stack multiplier if I had the Witching Hour equipped, as Icy Beings recommended. Oh, that was a short floor. But the Nemesis Bracers really help with your completion of the rifts. Because every pylon I hit will spawn a named boss or elite horde or both. I don't remember what it's called, but the health potion I have is a legendary, the one of the bottomless that automatically refills 60% of your health, and this one also gives you an additional, I want to say 90,000. you want for doing speed runs, you can add in the fleet-footed perk that the monk has as a passive, which will boost my movement speed another 10%. On the Torment 13, just Nephilimris for farming. I'll actually do that. Not on the higher greater rifts though, because it will nerf my survivability too much. So as you can see, I've been really well on time. I'm throwing a lot of name. Better. I'm throwing a lot of name enemies at me, which is great. Yeah, you can see my near-death experience counting down. That would have killed me. Stick around here to try to get the last 4% or move to. Yeah, let's move on to the next map. I just kind of hope I'm not going to be chained right at the entrance with a bunch of mobs. No, this is bad.
Your strength fails.
So, I'll be getting the Rift Guardian here in a second.
The Rift Guardian.
He's actually one of the ones that I've had a harder time with this build. Just because you gotta be careful where his poison clouds are. And they're not always immediately noticeable with the aura I have surrounding me because of the sweeping wind that's always active. One of the times I faced him yesterday, I got screwed over because I stood in his poison cloud, I didn't realize it. So yeah, this is the same build that I went through with my 75 run. So now I'm working on getting my gems up for the next conquest, which I think is 3 to 65, so I'll be heading back into the upper 70s again to try to finish the season out. So I did talk a little bit about the Icy Veins build for the Wave of Light DPS. I'll put a link to that in the comments so you can see the comparison of what I started with and then what I kind of tweaked my way to myself. You probably could get back some of the damage lost from not using the witching hour, the boost for critical damage, by empowering some of your ancient items with your legendary gems, Echonized Cube. And that's it. Hopefully this helped someone. If you like what you see, please click like, subscribe, notify. And that's it. Thanks.